In Oracle 11g at least, not sure about 10g on this one. But this function actually allows execution of arbitrary PLSQL statement. Now this is not really a flaw. This is a feature. So it's not like this is going to be patched or anything. So these two exploits, Java IO permissions and DBA permissions, it's like a feature. If your connection string user or your SQL injection has these two privileges, then you can call these two methods for executing OS code. So this create master process function lets you execute arbitrary PLSQL. So as an argument to this function, we issue a PLSQL in which we call a DBMS scheduler and schedule a job and then execute a job. And the job basically is to execute OS code. So simple as that. Right. So thankfully, you don't have to remember any of that. We have written a tool for you, which is called BSQLBF, which lets you automate all of these exploits. It has some other exploits as well, like DBMS Repcat, RPC, which I haven't talked about. And if you're interested, feel free to read the manual. So I have actually a demo of this. Right, so we're going to be exploiting a SQL injection in Oracle again from web applications. And this is a blind SQL injection. So before when we did not know about this function, we were using this as a proxy to hack the internal databases. Now we know a little bit more about exploitation, and we're going to be using this particular function to execute OS code. So it's a blind SQL injection. You find a string to tell the tool that these are the true responses or these are the false responses. This is a new version. It comes with an executable. So let me just pause this for a minute. So this version of BSQLBF lets you execute any arbitrary Metasploits payload onto the remote database. So what you do is you choose your payload, what you want to execute on the database, provide your IP address and a port number on which you want to throw a reverse shell. This will then run MSF payload, create the binary, which BSQLBF then will then upload and then execute on the box. So in this case, we're going to be choosing a VNC inject and try to get a reverse VNC session from the backend database server. So this is our IP address on which we will have the metapreter listening. So this will run MSF payload in the background, compress the exploit. So here are your two options. So what privileges do you have in the current session? So we say we currently have the Java IO privilege, and this will create a binary which I will then upload. It then tells you what are the steps next, because the exploit is now ready to be shipped onto the remote database. So you have to trigger, you have to run BSQLBF with certain parameters. You have to provide the URL. So all you do now is, so in the BSQLBF, you need to tell it that this is type 8, which is to do with Java IO permissions. You then launch the Metasploit, where you will catch the VNC session. And then we run the BSQLBF. Well, as you can see, our video editing skills are not as good as they should have been. So we run BSQLBF with the hyphen URL parameter. We provide the vulnerable URL. We provide the match string for blind SQL injection to make its job easier. We tell it it's a database 3, which stands for Oracle. It supports other databases as well. But I think for other databases, there are far better tools than this one. So hyphen CMD ref shell tells it that run the Metasploits payload, which we have already started. So you have the VNC session ready to be caught if ever you get one. So you run BSQLBF. It checks if we have Java IO permissions. It says, yes, you have it. So we will exploit it. It's now trying to upload the Metasploits payload, which we created using MSF payload. This can take a while. I mean, depending on your payload, if you're doing a reverse VNC or metapreter, this can be big or small. So yeah, eventually you will have a VNC session popped up on your screen from exploiting SQL injections. Yeah, so this is basically in Oracle, in Windows, Oracle usually run with system privileges. So you have a VNC shell with a shell, which is running a system. So if you want, you can just directly log on via a VNC shell. Okay, so next up, I actually wanted to talk about this class of vulnerability, which I believe is not that well discussed in the wild. And I'm not sure if there is a new name or if it deserves a new name in the wild. But anyways, we are calling it a second order SQL injection, which is a non-interactive SQL injection. So what we are seeing is a lot of organizations are now becoming security aware. They get their applications pen tested from time to time. But the admin section, or there are sections of the website like admin section, which does not really get pen tested. So imagine a scenario where you have a new user registration functionality. So you have an evil user coming onto your website and he's trying to do some SQL injections. But as you can see, the code against which he's injecting is actually using a bind parameter. So it's not vulnerable to SQL injection. So all his attempts over here are actually not be successful because the code is secure. But what happens is that, so after this user has injected his malicious code and it was not vulnerable, he goes away. Now an admin user logs into this website for moderation or account approval. And the code the backend code which gets executed when this admin user moderates this user's account is actually vulnerable to SQL injection. So if you look at this code here, it's basically whatever has been injected by the attacker that gets inserted as a row within a table, and that particular contents of the row of that table then gets passed on as string in one of the procedures. So this is a second order SQL injection in the admin screen, which the attacker does not have access to, and the attacker has no reasons to believe that his attack will ever be successful. So in the admin screen, the code which will get executed will look something like this. So clearly it is vulnerable to SQL injection, but the only user who gets to see this is the admin user, who hopefully is a trusted user. So in a nutshell, SQL injection does not occur within the attacker session. So attacker has no reason to believe there is a vulnerability there. So for example, attacker places an order via an e-commerce application. Admin logs in and approves the order. Admin session is vulnerable to SQL injection. And more importantly, the attacker's input gets passed to the vulnerable SQL call. So attacker do have a say in the SQL injection. It's just that he does not have a say in detecting whether there is a problem or not. Similarly, it could happen that this particular row which the attacker has created can be used in calling a trigger in some admin functionality somewhere. Might be because of a batch job run overnight. So it could be that particular row which the attacker has created in the table could be used in a trigger, and that trigger is vulnerable to SQL injection. Again, that trigger can be triggered as an action of a bad job. And on the similar lines, you can have a CSRF, cross-site request forgery, in the admin section. So if you are exploiting a cross-site request forgery in an admin section, then your payload, if successful, will only run once. So it's again what I would classify as a non-interactive SQL injection. You have no ways to interact with it. Maybe you can use out-of-band channels and extract some bulk data in one request. But other than that, you can't really make it interactive. So attacker payload executes only once. And can we make this exploit interactive? That was the big question. So that's when we looked at this concept of one-click ownage from Ferram Avituna. I mean, he already has something working in MS SQL. We looked at it from the perspective of Oracle. So the concept is simple. We create an MSF, we create an executable from MSF payload, which we want to upload onto the target server and execute on the target server. Now, the only problem is playing with the sizes. Because we will be injecting into Oracle database, and most of the places where we are injecting, they are of the default varchar size. So we had a restriction to have the entire argument passed into which cannot exceed more than 4,000 characters. So we looked at this concept. Essentially, what you do is you create a VB script that can process this hex string and generate a valid binary file. The hex string is basically the hex of the binary file. Right. So you use Metasploit's MSF payload. You create shell.exe. You convert that shell.exe into a compressed and a hex encoded string with a decryptor stub attached in form of a VB script. So shell.exe is compressed and hex encoded. It is then converted to one line, quite a big long line of VB code, which then gets executed on the machine and creates shell.exe. So you find a SQL injection, you create this VB script on your side, you upload this VB script onto that remote database server, you execute this VB script to create the executable of MSF payload, and then you run the executable. So that's how it looks like, that one big long line of exploit. This was Pharo's work for exploiting MS SQL injection, particularly for non-interactive ones. You issue this one request, and you have whatever Metasploit's payload you want to execute on the remote server coming back to you. This was for MS SQL, so it uses XPCMD shell and just runs a big payload. You can do the similar stuff in Oracle, as we've seen with if you have the Java IO permissions, you can call it in the fun call function or the other function which we've seen. Interestingly enough, when we tried to do it with DBA privileges, it wasn't that straightforward. Again, as I said, a DBA user can technically grant himself Java IO permissions and then run the exploit we showed previously. But the problem was that that permissions was not available in the same session. So you had to log out and log back in. And if you do that, then it's not technically one click. It's probably more than one click. And it kind of does not serve the purpose. You can do something like grant Java sysprivileges to public. But for a real pen test, I mean, that is a bit intrusive. You don't want to be playing with a public role. So what didn't work? So you remember we executed OS code with DBA privileges by calling kupp$proc function. And we used DBMS scheduler to execute OS code. Now the problem was the create program procedure of this DBMS scheduler can only take 1,000 characters as argument. So we were not able to pass this entire big line into one single line. So what finally worked? This is what we can think and what we came up with. So we decided to create a directory object on the Windows file. Within this directory, create a procedure to write files on the file system using util_file package. Execute the procedure to write a VB script, the VB script we saw earlier. Execute the VB script to create MSF payload executable, run the executable, and yeah, that's pretty much job done, all in one request. So that's how it looked like, this long, big request. If you run this one large, big request, you will have, again, Metapreter coming back and connecting to you. So we decided not to reinvent the wheel, and we just added a plugin to the Pharo's WebRadar tool. In this particular demo, we are using this for interactive exploitation. But the idea behind this was to use it for non-interactive exploitations. So again, we go back to our SQL injection, and I think we can skip the identification part because we've already identified that it's vulnerable. So next we fire up. This is how the WebRadar.